In late 1979, young son Ben was born with cerebral palsy. New albums emerged over the next 2 years, though the critical and commercial failure of 1980's Hawks and Doves and 1981's Reactor indicated that Young's priorities lay outside his music. In 1982, Young signed to Geffen and began work on a new album which would move away from the folk, rock and country idioms he was most comfortable working in. Influenced by the electronic music of German band Kraftwerk, Young's next album, Trans, was an unexpected detour.
I mean, certainly if Neil genuinely took the influence of Kraftwerk to himself, one, he did it 5 years later than everyone else, because certainly Kraftwerk, in terms of their influence upon punk and more particularly post-punk, you know, that influence was already well in effect by 78. She's a model and she's looking good. I'd like to take a home that's understood. She's playing hard to get, she smiles from time to time. I'm sure at some point you listened to Kraftwerk, but the idea that you could successfully assimilate that into, as I say, his very American-driven type of music. No, it's completely incompatible without rethinking the way that you're going to approach music. And as I say, I mean, obviously, he's not, up to that point in his career, it's not even like he's been following or experimenting with the kind of Velvet Underground MC5 kind of free jazz experimentalism or anything. It's, you know, it just isn't there, you know, electronic or free jazz. And, it, you know, it's Neil, I suspect, got into a trap in the early 80s, which is why he managed to upset David Geffen quite as much as he did, where he simply felt that he had to change for change's sake.
One of the interesting things about Trans is how late Neil Young comes to Kraftwerk. You know, Neil Young's almost discovered them and pretty late in the day and got intrigued by the whole thing. I think the album's also very much about his obsession with a new toy called the vocoder. He's got this vocoder and he wants to play with it, basically. He can disguise himself in it. The album's very much about disguise. Apart from the musical elements in it, you've also got a Neil Young new image, which also seems to be partly borrowed from Kraftwerk. He's actually cut his hair really short for the first time since probably 63 or something. And he's clean cut, just like Kraftwerk are, as an artistic statement almost. I don't know how self-consciously that was an artistic statement on Neil Young's part, but the visual aspect of it should not be underestimated, I feel.
I've tried very hard with Trans to find something in it. I've gone back to it and back to it, hoping that I'm going to discover something that I didn't necessarily hear it in the time. And, you know, I've failed woefully. I mean, it's an appalling album. I don't know what he was thinking. I mean, there is all of this background story about his son Ben having cerebral palsy and not being able to communicate with him, and that perhaps helps you understand what was in his mind when he made the record a little more, but it certainly doesn't make it any more listenable as a record, I'm afraid.
Well, I think with Trans, while Neil Young musically was influenced certainly by a group like Kraftwerk, he also was attempting to take songs that had roots in traditional folk and rock and sonically take them in a different communications direction. Because as we've learned, at that time when Trans was recorded, Neil Young's son Ben was going through some periods where Neil and his wife Peggy at the time had to devote so much energy to their young handicapped son that it took Neil's music in a direction that even he, I think, was surprised at. But if you listen to a song like Transformer Man, Computer Age, and how he took Mr. Soul and re-recorded it in a way that was quite remarkable in many ways. And I think Neil used some elements of these musicians that he was influenced by, but certainly he didn't consciously in any way try to copy a record like the Kraftwerk album of the day. Instead, I think he took what he knew how to do best, which was create these sonic landscapes such as Computer Age. Even if that song were played on an acoustic guitar, it'd be a great song. But as he used the vocoder and flowed in these electronic sounds, he created these songs that I think musically were able to help him convey what he wanted to say musically as well, about how you don't necessarily have to sound a certain way to communicate what you're trying to say. And I think with Neil's young son at the time, unable to communicate in traditional ways, I think he was trying to say on that record that I don't have to sound like myself to still get through to my audience.
I always thought it was a very good album, actually. It's a weak album in many senses because it's not consistent. It's a pity that he dilutes the album. In fact, the Kraftwerk-like songs on it are the strongest. I mean, Transformer Man and Sample and Hold are two great Neil Young songs, I think. They're surrounded by a kind of half-hearted series of songs, some from an earlier project like the Island in the Sun or whatever project. He can't resist throwing a few sweeteners in there, possibly to mollify the record company for all we know. If that was the case, then I think it was artistically wrong to do that. It doesn't quite go the whole hog. He hasn't made an experimental work in a way that, say, David Bowie did with Lowell or something, where you're going straight into the heart of it and I'm going to make a completely electronic record. He's not made an electronic record. He's kind of wanted the best of both worlds, and I think kind of slipped between the cracks a bit, and it's a shame that he didn't pursue it. But at the same time, there is some fantastic stuff on that record. I think it's not been given the full appreciation that it deserves.
The reaction of both critics and audiences to Trans was one of confusion, and Young decided to return to Nashville for his next record, Old Ways. Yet Geffen was unhappy with the results, and a struggle between Young and the record company owner began. A set of albums across the decade would indicate the disruption that this had upon Young's creativity. From 1983's Everybody's Rocking to 1987's Life, to many, it appeared that the prolific singer-songwriter had lost his muse.
He made only one good record during the 80 years, and that was Trans. And it probably has more to do with his feelings for his son and a certain amount of dumb luck than anything else. I mean, I feel as if that he and Geffen was expecting him to write another Heart of Gold, and that was why he'd hired him, and Young had no interest in doing that, and that he was throwing product against the wall for the first time in his life. I don't think he did it before, and I don't think he's done it since. I think a record like On the Beach doesn't seem, I mean, as eccentric as it was viewed as being and perverse as it was viewed as being at the time. You know, it's a realized piece of work. I don't find that to be true of the Geffen albums. They're hodgepodges, there are good songs on them, or there's that stupid rockabilly album, another case where people say, oh, he made this move. He figured out a way to make a record. Didn't work so good.